I'm so sorry. So, before we get started, I kind of want to tell a little story on this one, because the fact that this PowerPoint even exists is a little bit strange. Once upon a time, when I was teaching General Humanities, I was finishing up the class. We were coming to the end of all the readings and stuff. And I had a student literally ask me to my face, why aren't we talking about anything after World War II? Like, why does every class that proposes to talk about the humanities, or that talks about history, or that talks about, you know, Western Civ, or whatever you want to call it, why do they always quit after World War II, after, like, the 1950s? Why doesn't anyone talk about the Cold War? Why doesn't anyone talk about the 1960s? Why doesn't anyone talk about the 70s or 80s or any of that stuff? And I was a little taken aback by this, to be perfectly honest. Like, I recognized that this was, in fact, a problem. Like, in high school, I actually did have a class that covered America after World War II. It actually went into some detail about, like, the Vietnam War and about the 1980s. Not so much anything after that, because, you know, at that point it was, in fact, the early 2000s. There wasn't a whole heck of a lot of history in addition to that at that point. But I did really appreciate it, and the teacher was really good at talking about it, and, you know, we actually had conversations on the subject. And the fact of the matter is, there's probably some pretty good reason why that isn't that common. Like, I remember behind closed doors, like, we had a department meeting at one point, like, we were all discussing, we were all professors teaching General Humanities 2 at Montclair, and the person who was in charge of our, like, cadre, our group of teachers teaching this particular course, she specifically instructed us at one point, you know, like, to... We were kicking around ideas of how to talk about World War II, how to talk about the 20th century, and she specifically mentioned, you know, go as far as you feel comfortable in the 20th century. And the implication there was that it isn't comfortable to teach anything after World War II. It isn't comfortable to teach anything after the 20th century. And there are probably a lot of reasons for this. Like, I'm not speaking on behalf of anyone on this one besides what's going through my head as I'm preparing this discussion. Like, on the one hand, yes, I do want to fulfill what that student asked for, and indeed, in that class, we did spend the rest of the day talking about the Cold War. Like, extemporaneously, I just came up with, like, the 30-minute version of how to talk about everything after the 1960s in a nutshell. Something much less prepared than you're about to see. But at the same time, I can understand why professors are resistant to doing this, why this doesn't come naturally. And first and foremost is the most obvious, like, academia is famously slow. We want to get our facts straight, we want to understand what we're talking about, and most of us either study stuff that has happened in the 20th century exclusively, or we study history, like... back, like, ancient history, modern history, like, things that happened 150 years ago or longer. It's pretty rare that you end up studying both. Those people who end up studying literature and language and, you know, cultural movements of, you know, prior to the 20th century tend to be pretty locked in their perspective, and anything more recent than that is uncomfortable. And as for those professors who are, in fact, studying, you know, history since the 1950s, usually it's with a very narrow focus. Like, they are studying specifically the Reagan administration in the 80s, or they are specifically studying, like, Stalinist Russia, or they are specifically studying sociology or semiotics or, you know, film criticism. Something very particular that doesn't give them a grand, big perspective on this era. Which makes sense. This era is huge. Like, notice the image that I'm displaying here is actually a 1,000-piece puzzle that I found online. And on the one hand, you'll notice that, again, like, everything since the 1960s is kind of marginalized here. Like, we've got the Hindenburg, and we've got, like, World War II planes, and we've got, like, some classic cars from, you know, the 1930s, 40s, and beyond. And we've got, like, some classic iconography from the Cold War and from, you know, the Great Depression and stuff like that. But, you know, besides maybe the couple of hippies over at the left, or, you know, the space shuttle launch over on the right, like, and there is, in fact, a personal computer right under the space shuttle. Like, other than that, again, the 60s and beyond are kind of underrepresented here for some reason, though, you know, we'll talk about that. So getting a big picture of what's going on in the Cold War is kind of really difficult. On the other hand, I should also stress, it also gets really political. Like, again, the words my, like, section chair suggested were, you know, go as far as you feel comfortable. The implication here being that most people aren't going to be comfortable talking about what happens after the 1960s, just because it gets real political real fast, and what's more, it informs our time period's politics so much. Like, the contemporary liberal, conservative divide, the contemporary division between Democrats and Republicans here in the States is largely built during the 1960s through the 1990s. Like, the lines that have been drawn very much come down to what side were you on in Nixon's, you know, Republican Party or Reagan's Republican Party, the 70s and the 80s. Those allegiances haven't changed all that much in 40, 50 years, as weird as that may be to say. Like, sure, we have new politicians, we have new problems, we have new issues, but at the same time, like, people are arguing over pro-life versus pro-choice abortion stances now, and they were arguing over the exact same divide in the 80s. Not that much has changed to shift it. As much as Roe v. Wade was a big deal in the 70s and is now a big deal again because it has been overturned, really the political alignment hasn't shifted all that much in all that time, which means if you're going to talk smack about Reagan, you're talking smack about Trump. And if you're talking smack about Carter, you're probably going to talk smack about Biden as well. It's messy, it's not nearly that simple, but it doesn't change the fact that, again, you talk about politics in this era, you're talking about politics now, and your allegiances and your alignments will become obvious. What's more, it's just, again, hard to summarize, hard to encapsulate. Like, we've been doing a pretty good job, I think, of trying to sort of get at the big literary and artistic movements of, you know, history gone by in this class, but trying to do the same for the 1970s and 80s is way, way trickier. So we're gonna do our best to get at all of this, to try and get as much of this as possible, but I want to stress, like, this is not my wheelhouse. I was not trained to do this lecture. This is very much a kind of off-the-cuff, just trying to get at the big picture. The only person who has looked it over besides me at this point is my wife, who agrees that I hit everything that was super important while also, you know, missing so, so very much. So if you are watching this and you are in fact a scholar or a student of, like, the latter half of the 20th century, or for that matter, if you lived through it and you're like, hey, you missed X, Y, Z, why isn't the space race on here? Like, why isn't, you know, Khrushchev a thing? Why do you talk about certain American presidents, but you don't bother to talk about certain Soviet premiers? Cause this isn't my job, man. Like, cut me some slack. This is not exactly what I set out to do when I started teaching this course. But at the same time, I realize my students are hungry for information, my students want to know more about it, and I'm gonna do what I can with what I've got. So, with that in mind, we gotta start with, you know, the Cold War. My sort of historiographical approach to how I'm going to talk about this is going to be through the lens of the Cold War. To me, this is the big conflict, the political divide, the major ideological issue that is hanging over everyone's heads, both figuratively in the sense of, like, will capitalism triumph over communism, but also quite literally in the sense of, oh God, we could be bombed at any moment, please don't kill us, the other side of this conflict. The Cold War is, again, kind of the dominant thing hanging over everybody's heads, and for that matter, I think it is the dominant force that is informing the politics, the culture, the art, the literature of the time, as we'll talk about. So we're gonna use this as our starting point. there's a lot that we didn't cover in the last lecture on the 20th century, again, because this was kind of never the plan when I was originally setting this series up and when I recorded that lecture. So we had to kind of go back to what was going on during World War II quite a bit in order to get to what's going on here in the 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, you know, in this lecture. And what I want to start with here is the invasion of Germany. So, again, at the end of World War II, obviously, like, the Allies won. Big shocker there. But the conflict leading up to the conquest of Germany proved to be as important and, you know, historically significant as anything that was happening during the war proper. In fact, many sort of politicians and generals at the time kind of knew this. Like, once it was pretty clear that Germany was going down, that the World War II was going to end in the Allies' favor, it very much became a race between, on the one hand, the Soviets, on the other, the Allies, as to who was going to get to Berlin first. Because as much as the Allies, you know, like America, England, France, and the Soviet Union are all supposedly on the same side at this point, everyone knows that there's going to be a world war after this, that there is going to be another major conflict between the Soviet communists and the capitalists in the West. And who controls Germany might in fact have some major implications for history down the road. So this becomes an effort on the part of the European allies, the Western European allies, I should say, to try and get as much of Germany as possible. So when it comes down to negotiating with their ally, the Soviet Union, at the, you know, bargaining table at the end of this big war, that they will have a better position from which to say, no, you are not allowed to have as much territory as, you know, you want in this case. But as it happens, the Soviets are the ones who are rolling across Poland and rolling into Berlin first, so the American and British and French allies are kind of in a weaker position when it comes to that argument. They have, in fact, secured Italy at this point. Like, it wasn't the Soviets who took over all of Europe as part of, you know, World War II, which is fortunate as far as those allies are concerned. But Germany is divided. Like, both, again, figuratively and literally. The Soviets control a great deal of it when they sit down to the table for making agreements and making bargains, and peace is determined with a major part of Germany under Soviet control going forward. And this becomes actually really symbolic, which is why I kind of wanted to start here. It is sort of famously the case that Berlin, the capital of Germany at the time, is very much divided between the Soviets in the East and the Western European allies in the West, which doesn't make any sense because, as you can see, Berlin is well in Soviet-controlled territory at this point. Like, it is going to be an island of capitalist ideology in the midst of this giant sea of Soviet ideology. And consequently, the Soviets, like, literally build this wall right through the center of Berlin that is going to divide the Allied section from the Soviet section for literally decades. And this becomes just this huge symbol of Cold War thinking altogether, that the world is in fact divided between this capitalist and, you know, like, democratic ideology on the one hand, and the Soviet communist ideology on the other. And that's why if you watch, like, Cold War movies or Cold War set literature or whatever, you're probably going to see a lot of discussion about Berlin as, you know, kind of either the setting for these things, as is the case with, like, what was the movie that Spielberg made not too long ago? I forget the name, but yes, it was set in the Cold War. It was frequently set in Berlin. One of my wife's favorite movies is The Man from U.N.C.L.E., which is like a Guy Ritchie adaptation of the old spy TV show from, again, this era. And it is, once again, set largely in Berlin, where we see the divided city and, like, they actually have to get over the wall at some point. Again, this is symbolic of what the world looks like at this particular moment. These two conflicting perspectives, very much at odds with each other, very much vying for control of the world, and Berlin is kind of at the center of it all. Now, in this discussion, we're going to primarily focus on the American side of this whole issue. Like, again, there are two superpowers that emerge from World War II. The Soviet Russia on the one hand, representing the communists, and the United States, which very much, like, more than they much more than they did in World War One, contributed to the end of World War Two and very much engineered the victory for the Allies in World War Two. They will go on to be the major power sort of set against Soviet communism. And again, I'm going to focus on it largely from the American standpoint, and that's pure bias on some level. Like, yes, I recognize that I am reading American textbooks, and I am, in fact, an American, and, you know, I've been reading this and studying this whole era from the American perspective basically my whole life, insofar as I've studied it at all. On the other hand, I want to stress, like, hey, we just got through reading Mikhail Bulgakov's Master and Margarita for the last few weeks, and I think we're pretty comfortable understanding the Soviet perspective of themselves from a writer who represents them pretty well. Like, Bulgakov is certainly questioning and challenging Soviet ideology. We might be better off reading something like Shalakov's, you know, The Don Flows to the Sea, if we really want, like, a, you know, someone who's actually buying the Soviet ticket and not questioning its perspective and its thinking quite so much. But at the same time, I think Bulgakov does give us a pretty good idea of both the benefits and the dangers of living under Stalinist Russia. Now, that said, like, since we are going to focus on the American perspective, what I do want to sort of strongly suggest here at the outset is that this American perspective is not perfect. I am not going to treat the Americans as the heroes of the Cold War, as being the good guys against the communist menace. We will talk about that perspective, but I do want to emphasize that the Soviets especially were pretty good at figuring out how bad the Americans were at certain parts of managing their side of the world, managing their country in particular. Like, over here, we have this propaganda poster calling for the demilitarization of space. Like, we usually don't talk about the space race from that perspective so much, but the whole we won the space race by getting a dude to the moon faster is actually a major existential threat for, you know, Soviet Russia and the communists. Like, the space race wasn't just, hey, let's get a man to the on the moon, there is no potential danger to this, or, you know, as Scientologist L. Ron Hubbard once wrote in an introduction to Battlefield Earth, like, he and the science fiction writers were deliberately turning America's attention away from war and towards space so they could, like, avoid nuclear annihilation. No, the Russians understand, and so do the Americans, that if, in fact, we are conquering space, we are conquering space so we can use it for military purposes, so we could potentially launch missiles from the moon at Soviet Russia or at America, and therefore claiming the moon, getting there fastest, is in fact a military tactical decision. But the other one that I really do want to focus on quite a bit more is over here on the left. You'll notice this, again, Soviet propaganda poster of the Statue of Liberty on top of an American flag, which is now turned into prison bars with, like, a dollar sign and where the stars are usually. And notice especially, like, up here in the foreground, there's this black guy who's behind these bars. The Soviets are definitely emphasizing American inequalities. Like, don't get me wrong, the Soviets have not solved this problem. Like, as much as Soviet Russia, like, champions this communist ideology and claims that everyone is equal, it is very much not the case. And, you know, Stalin's riches and, like, Stalin standing over his people would definitely be comparable to, like, corporate bigwigs and, you know, capitalists standing over the poor and the working class. But the fact that it's that black guy up here at the front, the Soviets know, and the Americans know as well, that one of the major issues that American culture is currently facing is their race relations. They know that they have a major race problem here in the States. That if, in fact, America is going to try and promote itself as the leader of the free world, they better start freeing their own people pretty damn quick, or no one is going to take that seriously. This is a, like, America's worst secret at this particular point in time. And increasingly, you're going to find throughout this discussion, American forces and American sort of, like, propagandists to use a very loaded term that isn't accurate, but I'm not entirely sure what the correct term would be in this case. The pro-America party, let's say, is very keenly aware of the fact that their major weakness in the eyes of Europe and the rest of the world is how they treat their own people. How these economic inequalities can, in fact, mask major racial hostilities, major sort of ideological hostilities within their own nation. So when we talk about America here, as we're talking about the Cold War, I am not talking about the good guys in a fight between good versus evil. I am talking about a complicated and very problematic organization trying to present itself as the good guys in this war, and frequently being a bunch of horrible hypocrites, manipulators, and really using this war as an excuse to do some pretty terrible things. Nobody has clean hands in this one. I do not want to represent the Soviets as being sort of underdogs in this war, even though they arguably are. I do not want to represent them as being heroic alternatives to the Americans. Like, Stalin makes for a really terrible hero. But at the same time, the Americans are not the heroes here either. Communism does not represent some sort of solution to American excess in the same way that American freedom does not represent some solution to communist hypocrisy. Both are hypocrites. Both are basically oligarchs trying to, you know, argue against each other and vying for control of a greater share of the world, using their people as the playthings in this combat. It's gonna be ugly. But nonetheless, the headspace that I want us to be thinking from is the American one. Because this explains a lot of why the Americans, and for that matter the Soviets, are doing what they're doing during this conflict. We have to sort of enter the headspace of people who feel threatened by the expansion of the alternative ideology. For the Soviets, that means capitalist expansion. For the capitalists, this definitely means Soviet expansion. And this is the way that it's going to be framed in most pro-capitalist, pro-American propaganda, most art, etc. The Soviets are growing. They are taking more and more territory. They're expanding from their Russian fortifications into the Eastern European nations, into China, into Asia, into Southeast Asia, and beyond. They want as much control of the world as they can get, and we are the only thing standing in their way. So join the coalition of NATO, join the coalition of capitalist forces, join the group of free nations, and fight the threat of communism. This is how it is going to be framed throughout this period. And the other thing we need to mention, because for some reason we haven't, is that sort of hanging over this entire ideological conflict is the threat of nuclear annihilation. Russia and America are the two primary nuclear powers at this point in time. And we've done the homework, we've done the science, we've seen the destructive potential these weapons have. If in fact we end up in all-out nuclear war, everyone loses. There are no survivors. This is the last of the wars. I believe, to paraphrase Einstein, he said something along the lines of, I don't know what World War III will be fought with, but World War IV will be fought with sticks and stones. We will bomb ourselves back to the Stone Age with whatever technology we are using. So it is imperative on both of these ideological opposites to not let this boil into open war. Instead, we're going to have to fight this war from the shadows. Which brings us to proxy wars. The way the Cold War is going to be fought is America and Russia, the capitalists and the communists, are going to be fighting ideologically over control of completely different countries than them. We are going to have the Korean War in the 50s and 60s, where the South Koreans are going to be protected and sort of armed by, again, our American capitalist forces, where North Korea is going to be backed by a communist China, communist USSR regime and leadership, which will ultimately give us the North Korea and South Korea that we recognize to this day, including all of the problems and political issues that go along with that. Likewise, the United States is frequently going to tangle with Russia on the subject of Cuba. Cuba has gone full communist, full Soviet, full, you know, anti-American sentiment after a series of political debacles and the U.S. messing around in their business for way too long. And this presents a huge problem to the United States, because if, in fact, the Soviets get to relocate missiles to Cuba, that gives them a whole lot of reach over major American cities, major American population centers. It would be very easy for them to bomb us without us being able to retaliate, which is why the Cuban Missile Crisis is such a huge deal. Now, I should stress that the Americans kind of want to have the same situation with respect to Russia. Like, the fact that the United States wants to relocate missiles into Western Europe to get access to Moscow and St. Petersburg in the same way that missiles in Cuba would have access to New York and Washington, D.C., is a major strategic consideration here. Additionally, you'll note that before the Cold War, the United States has 48 states. We've kind of gotten used to looking at maps of, you know, the 50 states with, like, Hawaii and Alaska stuck down in the corner because they clearly don't connect to any of the other 48 states. But this was a major strategic consideration during the Cold War. Alaska and Hawaii offered major Western outposts. It offered major opportunities for the United States to bomb and to, you know, have this buffer zone between a potential Soviet invasion and whether from the sea or, you know, over the, like, Bering Strait. This was a tactical consideration, in short. And, of course, there's Vietnam. Like, Vietnam is the big one. If you have heard of any of these proxy wars, you've probably heard of Vietnam, because once again, we have the North Vietnamese, backed by Communist China, starting to, you know, take over the whole country, and the Vietnamese, who are resisting this takeover, allied themselves with the states. The United States gets involved in this war, even though they have no idea what they're doing in this particular situation, and as much as for the better part of a decade, we're going to be fighting in Vietnam, ultimately, the South Vietnamese lose, the North Vietnamese overtake the country, and Vietnam falls to the Reds on this one. Now, I should stress that all three of these are, as much as they are frequently framed as wars, the Korean War, the Vietnam War, are mostly just giant ideological conflicts, debacles in most cases. You'll note that both the Cuban Missile Crisis and the Korean War kind of leave us with major political problems going forward. Like, there is still a great deal of hostility between the United States and North Korea. The conflicts with Cuba have toned down significantly since Castro's death, but it doesn't change the fact that South America is kind of another major hostile place with respect to the U.S., which brings us to the proxy wars you probably haven't heard as much about. Those three wars are pretty sexy because they, you know, involve actual, like, boots on the ground for the Americans, and because they frequently brought us either closer to nuclear annihilation, as is the case with the Cuban Missile Crisis, or because we either won or spent a whole bunch of cultural baggage trying to, you know, overcome whatever conflict we were involved in there. These proxy wars are less publicized because they had less influence on American culture at large, but nonetheless involve a lot of American involvement. The Soviet-Afghan War was a war where basically the Soviets were trying to gain a foothold in Afghanistan, and the United States very much opposed Soviet invasions by supporting the Afghanis kind of on the quiet here. I should stress, though, that the same revolutionaries who were preventing the incursions of the Soviets into Afghanistan turned out to be pretty closely aligned with the Taliban in the future. America didn't know it at the time, but they were arming the same terrorists who were going to be responsible for 9/11 down the road. Those allegiances are more complicated than I'm making them out to be, but nonetheless, it doesn't change the fact that these sorts of proxy wars meddling around in other governments, meddling around in other people's lives, does tend to backfire as a rule. One of the most obvious examples of this is with Iran. over here in the Middle Eastern Cold War. Like, this is not fully describing at all what's going on here. But America has been meddling in Iranian politics throughout the 1950s and 60s, which kind of comes to a head in the 70s and 80s when the Iranians get sick and tired of shipping all of their oil overseas to America. They're tired of Americans meddling with their elections and, in fact, overturning their government on one particular occasion. So they shut the whole thing down, throw out the guy, the pro-American ruler who they currently have, and push their sort of fundamentalist Islamic leader into power instead, which will devolve into the Iran-Contra scandal as we know it in the United States, where a bunch of Americans were held hostage in Iran for quite some time. Again, largely because the Iranians really didn't want them there anymore and really didn't want Americans meddling in things anymore. But this kind of boils over into a whole conflict between Saudi Arabia, with its American allegiances, and Iran, with its increasing Soviet allegiances. We are going to see more conflict in the Middle East as a consequence of, again, the Soviets and the Americans mucking about in elections, meddling with government, and basically sticking their nose where it doesn't belong. And South America is just a whole nother ball of mess as far as that's concerned. Notice that all of the red countries here, like Haiti and Panama, they involve actual straight-up U.S. invasions at one point or another. The CIA is involved in multiple coups across the South American countries, including, like, Brazil and Argentina. Like, the Americans are very interested in keeping the Soviets and the communists out of South America at the cost of, in many cases, supporting other cruel regimes. You know, just as the support of the Afghanis leads to the rise of the Taliban, you know, backfiring against American interests, the same governments that are sort of supported by the United States to, you know, oppose Soviet incursions and to prevent the communists from getting a foothold in South America will turn out to be the same drug cartels and drug cartel-packed governments that, you know, will be kind of plaguing America during the drug war in the 1990s and beyond. All this is to say, this is what the Cold War looks like. It is the United States and Soviet Russia mucking about in other nations' sovereign elections or mucking about with their politics behind the scenes, on the quiet, in order to try and prevent the expansion of one or the other ideological framework. If one country is looking especially capitalist and that country is important to the Soviet economy or regime, then you better believe that a bunch of Soviet agents are going to show up to muck around in their politics. Likewise, if, you know, Iran is thinking about getting rid of its leader who is helping the United States with their oil interests, you better believe that the United States are going to send people over there to sort out their government. Which means, if there is a major player that we need to talk about here in the whole, like, Cold War world, it's the spies. Now, this is not a totally new thing. Like, spies have always been a thing. Getting intel during a war is always a big deal. You know, as early as, like, Sun Tzu's The Art of War in, like, the 3rd or 4th century, he's literally saying all you need to do is know your enemy and know yourself, and you don't need to worry about the outcome of any war. Clearly, intel is the top military asset as these things go. This takes on a whole new level here in the Cold War. Because since the entire sort of power struggle of the Cold War depends on mucking about in other countries' elections without kind of being noticed, because that would be a PR disaster, we are seeing the rise of major espionage organizations, the CIA in the United States and the KGB over in Soviet Russia, which are kind of primarily responsible for getting this information, for, you know, making sure that either American or Soviet interests are realized, whereas American and Soviet interests can't be, like, publicly acknowledged, or where intervention would be considered some kind of problem. So increasingly, these agencies are getting a lot of power and are given a lot of influence to changing the course of world affairs. The CIA is going to muck about in people's elections. The KGB is going to muck about in coups. This is the way the world is going to look for now. And I want to stress that on the one hand, we're talking about, like, hard power in the sense of, you know, countries rising and falling, coups and assassination attempts, and, you know, world stability or instability as may be beneficial to either faction. We also have to recognize that this is about soft power, too, where soft power represents sort of cultural influence. The CIA and the KGB are both well aware of the fact that as much as this is a war about which countries follow which countries are Soviet allies and which countries are capitalist allies, which would be advantageous for economic interests like oil or strategic interests like where we can put missiles, we also have to recognize that this is a war for hearts and minds. You can do as much damage to the enemy and win as many points for your own nation by, you know, having a PR, like, benefit to some other country as, you know, causing trouble. As much as we usually think of France as being a staunch capitalist and very much a Western European ally, there was a time where France's communist sympathies made it seem like they might tip over to the Russian side. Not necessarily because there were some sort of mucked-about meddled election, but rather because the artists and the scholars and the thinkers of the time were sympathetic to communist interests. Remember, it's just after the 19th century. Marxism seemed like a way better solution to the monarchies of the 19th century than, you know, leaving it in the hands of capitalists who were causing major labor problems at the time. So as much as this is a war about proxy wars in other nations, we should also emphasize this is a war about, again, how do you control the airwaves? How do you get your message out there? And especially in the 1960s and beyond, we are talking about some pretty powerful tools to get into the hearts and minds of people in America, in Russia, and everywhere else as well. Again, we didn't talk about it much in the other lecture because we were kind of laser focused on, like, just the World War I, World War II situation. We've seen the rise of some pretty new technologies that radically changed the dissemination of information here in the 20th century. Radio on the one hand, which has at this point easily infiltrated every home in America, it seems. The cinema has become the dominant artistic form and medium of the 20th century, far outstripping the reach of like books, literature, and you know, other plastic art forms. Like, you can only put a sculpture or a painting in one place, but you film a movie and you can show it in every movie house in America and beyond. And of course, here in the 1960s, we're seeing the rise of television. Not only can we reach, you know, every American with, like, films, visual moving pictures the way that we do in a cinema, but we can actually beam those pictures directly into their homes. And with the rise of television, we see, like, massive political broadcasts, debates being publicly broadcast on television, the president being able to beam himself directly into everybody's homes in the case of important political announcements. As much as these are huge, important technologies, certainly rivaling the likes of the printing press back in the 15th century, with the sheer reach and scope and the ability to disseminate information very quickly, we should also recognize that these tools have their downsides as well. The printing press enabled scientists and artists to share their ideas, sure. They'd also enabled, like, religious fanatics like the Protestants to share their ideas, and massive schism, conflict, and war followed. Not that I'm necessarily an opponent of the Protestant Reformation, mind you, just recognizing that when you spread ideas quickly, conflict usually follows. So, on the one hand, we are seeing huge new artistic movements. We are seeing new intellectual properties. The way that you can spread this information, these ideas, and these characters, and these stories so quickly in this day and age, and have them be so compelling, means that we're going to have these major popular culture icons. Bugs Bunny, Superman, Mickey Mouse. We're going to get, like, serials like Flash Gordon, or, you know, the stories of Edgar Rice Burroughs, Tarzan, and John Carter of Mars. Like, these become major fixtures in the American popular consciousness, and they will absolutely get exported overseas. Everyone's going to be talking about these characters. They are going to be worldwide phenomena. This represents a whole new world of art in some respect. Like, it's not totally new. In the 19th century, we saw a sort of increasing awareness of these sort of popular heroes and popular storytelling. Things like Sherlock Holmes and Arthur Conan Doyle's publications in The Strand, or The Scarlet Pimpernel, Baroness Orsi's various stories of, you know, this hero during the French Revolution who, like, snuck in and freed people from the guillotines. We should emphasize that there has been a growing attempt to sort of direct art and literature at everyone rather than just an elite select few. But we have never seen it spread so rapidly as we do in the early 20th century when using the radio, using cinema, using television, we are able to get new characters into the hearts and minds, into the homes, into the television sets of all of these people across the world. And I want to stress, this is crazy powerful. Like, as much as, you know, shadow wars behind the scenes in Vietnam or Afghanistan may very well be a major contributing factor to turning the tide of the Cold War, I should stress, Bugs Bunny probably did a lot more for the American forces in the Cold War than any of those, like, proxy wars ever did. American popular, like, production is just extraordinary as a force during the Cold War, and this soft power is going to be incredibly potent as time goes on. But I want to stress that as much as, like, Bugs Bunny and Superman seem relatively benign as popular culture and tools of potential ideological training and brainwashing are concerned, we should recognize that these tools have been used for directly propagandistic purposes before, and probably will be again during this period. The CIA, the KGB knows that popular characters, popular entertainment, is a powerful tool of propagandistic control. We have famous cartoons of Bugs Bunny messing with the Japanese. We have famous cartoons from Disney where, like, Donald Duck is clearly opposed to Hitler's regime. And Superman comics very much kick off with him beating up Nazis and, you know, definitely standing for American interests in World War II. So you better believe that, again, if the CIA is sitting there thinking, how do we win the Cold War? How do we increase American interest? How do we increase American popularity? They're thinking about popular culture. They're thinking about the way that this can be used for propagandistic purposes. But this is not enough for the CIA. Because as far as the CIA-Soviet conflict is concerned, the Soviets have a definite advantage on the artistic front. As far as, you know, scholars and artists and art critics are concerned. They are very much recognizing that as much as America has Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck and Goofy and Superman and Bugs Bunny, this is not highbrow art. And at the end of the day, you gotta get those scholars and you gotta get those, you know, rich people with their elite interests to back you as well. So the CIA is going to expand their interest to art proper. At this point in history, though, we're going to see it working on essentially two fronts. We are going to see, on the one hand, the CIA attacking communism at home and disseminating capitalism abroad as much as they possibly can. The first part of that, attacking communism at home, very much takes the form, kind of in its most dramatic version anyway, of McCarthy's Red Scare, especially in the 50s and 60s. McCarthy very much paints a picture of a world where the communists are trying to overthrow the capitalists and destroy freedom on every front. And McCarthy very much frames this as, like, your neighbors, the people who live in your town, they could secretly be communists. We need to purify this nation from its potential communist leanings. We need to stop artists with communist sympathies from getting the ear of the public and potentially brainwashing them into communist ideologies. And this very much ends up being kind of an attack on Hollywood, on art, on literature itself. Increasingly, artists are accused of and condemned for having communist sympathies or promoting communist material, which kind of comes to a head when no fewer than 10 major Hollywood sort of directors and writers and actors and other major influencers get essentially, like, blacklisted and arrested, in fact. Like, Hollywood blacklisting goes on for quite a while under McCarthy's Red Scare, largely because of the pressure that he is sort of pushing on these supposedly liberal artists in this town that is very much associated with labor unions and therefore with communism by extension. This kind of gives rise to sort of two different reactions from Hollywood. On the one hand, we're going to see quite a few works of art like The Crucible or The Front, which confront the blacklists and condemn them, see them as ridiculous. Like, these people are not trying to promote communism, they're just trying to do art, and sometimes art entertains these ideas. On the other hand, we are going to see a lot of Hollywood movies that deal with paranoia directly. Like, my all-time favorite is Invasion of the Body Snatchers, which is this great science fiction film about, like, pod people invading America, and, like, all these people who are, like, quietly raising these evil alien, like, vegetable pods that duplicate your neighbors and turn them into aliens. Like, it's crazy and wonderful and incredibly paranoid and a really stressful thing to watch, in fact. Like, if you're into that sort of thing. But this whole idea that your neighbor could be a pod person, your neighbor could be taken over by aliens, your neighbor could be working for the enemy, is exactly the kind of McCarthy-esque paranoia that is sort of encouraging all of this criticism, all of this questioning, all of this challenging of artistic ideals. What I want to stress is where we've talked about art in terms of movements in the past, and where artists like the Dadaists or the Surrealists kind of deliberately and directly opposed political intervention. Like, the Dadaists expressly emphasized that they were going to make art that could not be turned into propaganda. To some degree, they were right. Their art didn't end up serving the purposes of propaganda because it was just so weird and so out there. But it also wasn't nearly as influential as, again, Bugs Bunny or Donald Duck. It was impenetrable for most audiences. It remained something of a curiosity, rather than becoming a major important movement that would, in fact, you know, influence the rest of the world and the average person on the streets. That isn't to say it isn't important, just that to some degree, art that does or can be turned to political purposes is going to become much more popular and much more successful when political forces are going to support the creation of certain kinds of art. Which brings us to the CIA. Like, this is relatively recent news. Like, in the past 20, 30 years or so, the CIA has released a number of files and a number of, like, documents sort of detailing their involvement in various art movements, especially in the 60s, 70s, and beyond. And it goes real deep, like weirdly deep. And on the one hand, I realize that by talking about this, I'm going to sound pretty tinfoil hatty, like, oh, the CIA is responsible for all of the artistic things that have happened in, like, the last 60 years. That's not true. What I want to emphasize is that the CIA did, in fact, have a pretty substantial branch dealing with funding art and sort of getting members or ex-CIA members into positions of significant power at major, like, art houses or publications. The Paris Review, for example, a very influential periodical that was kind of deliberately targeted at European like, pro-American sympathizers overseas, was very much helmed by an ex-CIA or maybe working CIA officer. We should also stress that there was, like, a major executive over at Paramount Pictures. The movie Giant, for example, which nobody's ever heard of or watched from what I can tell. It was one of those big, like, epics in scope, 3-hour movies from the 1950s and 60s, kind of like Gone with the Wind or indeed Dr. Zhivago. It was questioning a lot of American race relations. There was a lot of discussion in this movie and in the script about the relations between America and Mexico in particular, and the exploitation of Mexican labor. It was very much shut down at Paramount, largely at the behest and the encouragement of the CIA guy who was working in the upper echelons of the executive offices. In short, they were involved. And possibly the two things that I kind of want to stress, like, they're working positively to promote anti-socialist art on the one hand, and they're working negatively to kind of shut down communist sympathizers on the other. Over here on the left, we have a picture of what is, like, one of the most important buildings. Like, it's the part of the Writers' Workshop in Iowa. The Iowa Writers' Workshop is famous for being, like, one of the most important writing workshops in the country. Like, I actually applied there a couple of times when I was, like, trying to pursue my creative writing and did not get in. It's super competitive. The Iowa Writers' Workshop was actually partially funded by the CIA, and they... There is significant evidence to suggest that the major writing axiom, show, don't tell, was in fact kind of engineered with CIA interests in mind. Again, like I said, communist art was kind of a big deal in Europe at this point. Like, as we've seen, Russian literature, Russian art had been widely accepted and respected by the European world. Writers like Dostoevsky and Tolstoy, these were major players and major artistic contributors. The Russian artistic scene had been basically exploding since the late 19th century, and Russian artists, Russian writers, Russian poets were getting very influential, especially in promoting communism overseas or outside of, you know, Soviet interests. And the CIA figured they needed to fight this somehow. But the trouble is, they couldn't necessarily talk about social interests in American literature, because at the end of the day, that would backfire pretty horribly. Communism sounds a lot better than capitalism when it comes to promoting the plight of the oppressed and poor people. So the CIA's kind of approach here was, okay, if the ideological agendas of many artists are against us, then we need to promote art that doesn't have an ideological agenda. So instead of spending long passages talking about the glory of, you know, communism or the plight of the oppressed, instead, we need to emphasize an artistic approach that doesn't talk about ideology at all. Show, don't tell. Don't use your art or your literature as a platform for your politics. Instead, politics should be out of literature. Your literature should just talk about people, should talk about the way that life works. It should be grounded and dramatic, and that's what good art actually is. So you'll find that most American art in the latter half of the 20th century is just that. It's modeled on the Raymond Carver style of, like, inter-household drama or, you know, intimate psychological portraits of various individuals, rather than trying to make grand statements about the state of art, literature, politics, you know, the injustices all around us, criticism of the military or the capitalist industrial complex. Like, that tends to be pretty tough to find, but we'll come back around to that. The CIA was also very keen in promoting anyone they could find who was coming from Russia and had an anti-Soviet agenda. So Boris Pasternak was a famous poet and writer in Soviet Russia at this time, and he had kind of been quietly working on this novel called Dr. Zhivago for quite a while, which was like this epic story spanning the Russian Revolution and discussing sort of the actual state of affairs in Russia at that time. And importantly, Pasternak was not necessarily directly critical of the Soviet regime, but there were multiple characters who were at least interrogating the legitimacy and the, you know, goodness of this Soviet regime, which was something that the Soviets really did not want. So Pasternak knew that there was kind of no way this novel was ever going to get published during his lifetime, even though he was working on it. But the CIA, having heard the rumors about this major Russian artist working on a potentially anti-Soviet novel, definitely reached out to Pasternak and said, "We will publish this sucker abroad and make sure that you are talked about in every, you know, every major literary discussion in the world if you just give us the manuscript." Now, Pasternak had conditions. He wanted to make sure that he was protected, so he wanted to ensure that, like, they were not going to release it with the expectation that he had somehow condoned this. Like, he did work with them, but hesitantly, and wanted to make sure that he was kept out of this whole discussion, that it was an accidental leak, not anything that he had permitted or encouraged. The CIA did not pay any attention to this. They did not care. They promoted this thing from the rooftops. Notice that even the poster here says not just Dr. Zhivago, but literally Boris Pasternak's Dr. Zhivago. Like, we're going to promote the writer just to emphasize he is from Soviet Russia. He is on the inside. He is seeing this happen on the ground level. And they even gave the guy a Nobel Prize for this novel. Like, My understanding is that the CIA didn't necessarily orchestrate this, but they were definitely shaking hands and making deals behind the scenes in order to encourage this to happen. Pasternak himself did okay. Like, he didn't end up in a gulag or something. He, however, did get very strongly observed. This would become kind of his last major work because the Soviets were not interested in giving him a platform at this point. And as much as he survived relatively unscathed, his mistress, who was also his editor, probably did disappear into a gulag and probably did get tortured and horribly, you know, mistreated by the Soviets. So the CIA definitely mucked about with Pasternak's life and did not do him the service that he asked them for in exchange. They were interested in promoting anti-socialist ideals by any means necessary, and that's pretty obvious. They did not care about Pasternak's welfare or the people who Pasternak wanted to protect. On the other hand, we should also stress that people who didn't agree with these sort of show-don't-tell, let's not criticize America, let's not criticize, you know, social problems perspective, the CIA tended to go after them pretty hard. So Ernest Hemingway, who we did talk about a little bit during our last lecture, he was kind of best friends with Fidel Castro and had in fact like left America quite a long time ago, even though he was, you know, supposedly an American author and was very popular as an American author and novelist. He had started living in Cuba and was very sympathetic to communist interests and had even started to write more socially conscious literature in his latter career, stuff like To Have and Have Not, which the title kind of gives it away on this one. In the last years of Hemingway's life, he reported that, like, he was being harassed by FBI agents in his home in Cuba, that they were, like, bothering him, across the ocean. And while most of his friends at the time dismissed this as just paranoia, like, Hemingway ultimately committed suicide, and this was considered pretty good evidence that he was actually mentally disturbed. Yeah, it turns out the FBI did in fact have massive files on Hemingway and had in fact been pestering him and harassing him, and it is entirely possible that that was part of the reason why Hemingway committed suicide. Likewise, over here down at the bottom right, this is James Baldwin, another very important American writer from the 1950s and 60s. He was also very critical of American race relations in particular and was getting pretty popular overseas, and many of the periodicals that the CIA either controlled or partially funded or had, you know, connections with refused to publish some of James Baldwin's more inflammatory work. Again, if the war for hearts and minds in Europe was very much circulated around, on the one hand, the communists being equal, if occasionally, you know, stepping on freedoms, versus the capitalists who promise freedoms, but really only for the rich and those who are, you know, already powerful, Baldwin was not a welcome voice as far as the CIA was concerned. His work did in fact get published, but usually not in American-controlled periodicals with the CIA's involvement. They made Baldwin's life pretty difficult as well, though probably not as, you know, much direct harassment as is the case with Hemingway. Baldwin was very much attacked in CIA-controlled articles, and his work was thoroughly criticized by CIA-controlled, like, mouthpieces and platforms, which kind of reads as super racist in hindsight, and kind of in a big way was. If, in fact, the CIA was trying to make America sound really that great, lying about it and wallpapering over some of its difficulties was not necessarily a good plan. But the fact is that kind of all of this ended up backfiring. In the later part of the 1960s and into the 1970s, we see a huge movement throughout America, like multiple huge movements, all sort of coming together or splitting apart depending on the alignment of their interests, kind of opposing American control of their lives and the injustices that we are talking about here. We have the Civil Rights Movement and the March on Washington as depicted here, or Woodstock and the hippie movement opposing the Vietnam War and the proxy war policy of American interests in the CIA for years at this point. We have John Lennon and major artists like Yoko Ono here protesting the war with their bed-ins after their marriage and John Lennon's large departure from the Beatles, or I think this was technically during his you know, tenure with the Beatles, but it's not long after this that he and Yoko kind of leave, based on other problems that are going on with the band. And up here at the top right, this is the one picture taken on the first night of the Stonewall riots, where, like, police were assigned to shut down some landlord's, you know, not-up-to-code establishment, only to find out that it was actually a gay club. And this was perceived, probably correctly, as a form of like prejudice, homophobia, which erupted into violence later on in the and for several days a series of riots and protests would sort of, how do I put this, riots and protests that sort of kicked off the increasingly prevalent gay movement throughout the 60s, 70s, and beyond. What I want to stress is that as far as the CIA is concerned, everything at home is going fine, there is no cause for alarm, all is well. But that same show-don't-tell attitude, that same disinterest in sort of like ideological promotion very much does backfire on them. In empowering these intellectuals and artists, they in fact kind of pave the road for people with an actual ideological agenda. In sort of fighting against, like, people dissenting against this view of 1950s American conformity and, you know, American utopian society, we are in fact setting the stage for a lot of people to take their platforms and use them to protest, to argue against the CIA, and the CIA at this point has nothing that they can really do about these things. They have made these structures exist in some cases. They have empowered these individuals in some cases. So throughout the 60s and 70s, we're going to see increasing dissatisfaction with the state of America, dissatisfaction with their foreign policy, dissatisfaction with the state of art, and more people pushing back against this, again, McCarthy-esque worldview of everybody is either on our side or against us. This doesn't necessarily mean that there are going to be a lot more communists in America. There are, like, quite a few people who will be sort of vocally sympathetic to the Communist Party or to the Soviet interest, but these protests kind of become rolled into American culture in some respect. The trouble is, as much as the 60s was a time of optimistic protest, the 70s are a time of pessimistic protest. And increasingly, the hippie movement becomes more and more nihilistic, even as it, you know, grows and spreads. And part of this is because in the 1970s, the American outlook is in fact radically changing. We are seeing greater and greater political upheavals, more evidence that we cannot trust our politicians, that our investment in you know, overseas interests is in fact going to backfire on us. We obviously see, you know, the rise and fall of Richard Nixon. His second effort at becoming president is revealed to be full of, you know, election manipulation, and the famous Watergate incident leads to Nixon's own resignation from office. Over here on the left, I have a picture from the energy crisis of the later 1970s, where under Jimmy Carter, like, multiple problems in the Middle East and, you know, oil reserves sort of running low caused there to be massive shortages across the country, huge lines at gas pumps, and total lack of fuel at many of those same gas stations, which again sort of brought up a lot of issues. Americans were dissatisfied with the running of the country, but increasingly it was obvious that reliance on overseas oil was actually causing America to be financially and unstable and insolvent. Carter actively opposed the reliance on foreign oil, which would honestly, if they had cut it off, it would destabilize the entire American economy. That reliance had become so strong. We should also stress that in the 1970s, art was becoming more pessimistic as well. Like, I included the poster from Stanley Kubrick's Clockwork Orange here, largely because I think this is a really important story that kind of gives you the whole picture of what's going on here. Like, in the 1970s, the whole Hollywood studio system had kind of fallen apart. In the late 1960s, there had been this push to release these big budget movies like Giant or like The Sound of Music, all these major musicals and major epic scope films, and they were released so frequently that people really couldn't get out to see them as often as they were expected to, And since these movies cost so much to make, they very frequently failed at the box office, causing major losses among Hollywood studios. Some truly famous examples include, like, Hello, Dolly, the extremely expensive but kind of totally mismanaged Hollywood musical that absolutely flopped, or the famous Cleopatra, which was, like, this big Ten Commandments-esque swords and sandals epic that was cost like so much money to make and ended up making like no money back at the box office. The studios largely fell apart. Some just closed down entirely, like RKO. Many others kind of restructured, but increasingly the 1970s were an age of small, artistic, independently made and funded projects like Clockwork Orange here. It was the age of auteur directors. Famous names like Kubrick or Alfred Hitchcock would make movies, and they would be sort of, like, smaller in scale, but greater in artifice. Clockwork Orange itself, though, is incredibly pessimistic. It's this dark, like, dystopian world where these young hooligans are going out at night and killing people and raping people, and the movie itself used to include a very graphic rape scene that won the movie an X rating amongst the, like, usual rating system that we have, i.e. it was basically considered pornography. The movie is so dark, so grim, so pessimistic, and it kind of stands for the 1970s at that time. But what's more is the movie was actually based on this book by Anthony Burgess, which was, you know, he was originally a British writer, and the book had been very successful in America, which was why Kubrick adapted it. But Burgess's novel actually had a happy ending. There was a 21st chapter where young Alex, you know, decides to go on the straight and narrow, decides that all of his violence and rape was actually pointless and senseless, and it would be better to be a moral human being. But interestingly, that version of the story didn't get published in America. When Burgess presented it to an American publisher, the publisher said, you know, we can't accept this. We can't print this. This is not how good art works. Good art is dark. Good art is pessimistic. This seems like a cheap ending. So the book was published in America without the last chapter, and this was the version that Kubrick adapted, never knowing that there was a 21st chapter where Alex changes his whole life out of his own desire. This is the moment in history where art must be dark, must be nihilistic. People won't buy it otherwise. There is this grim, suspicious pessimism that sort of just overtakes the entire 1970s outlook. Whether it's from the bottom up, people actually want this kind of art, or whether it is from the top down, artists just want to impose this art on their audiences, is not entirely clear. But it is pretty obvious that in 1977, when George Lucas makes an optimistic movie about, you know, beating the space Nazis because the power of friendship and hope, everyone goes to see that one, and this very much kicks off a new age in both art and also in politics. The 1980s represent a big move away from that pessimism of the 1970s. Yes, we can't trust our politicians like Nixon anymore, and yes, we are still reliant on foreign interests like Carter demonstrated with oil, but Reagan's attitude is, if we're going to fix this, we're going to fix it by shrinking the power of government. We're going to trust the corporations. We are going to deregulate them, give them more free rein over American culture, give them more power to make money, and we are going to privatize everything. We are going to give them more control over the government agencies that are currently working on a public level. Reagan's theory was that by deregulating, by giving more power to corporations, by allowing CEOs to sort of like govern and sort of regulate themselves, they would necessarily be making more wealth, and therefore would be able to make more jobs, which would bring more wealth to more people, and what he called trickle-down economics, or Reaganomics, as it's usually described. I am not an economist. It is not within my area of expertise to talk about whether or not this was successful. From what I understand, having talked to people who do know what they're talking about, I understand that there's a lot of disagreement on this one. On the one hand, the idea of giving corporations pretty much free rein to do whatever they want means we get a lot more corporations and a lot more powerful corporations. This is going to kick off a wave of mergers, like what we've seen in the last couple of decades with, you know, Disney buying Fox or Microsoft buying Activision Blizzard. This also is going to kick off an era of, you know, corporations getting more and more wealthy, leading us to, like, mega corporations like Amazon.com, something that almost certainly wouldn't have been possible before the Reagan era of deregulation and privatization. And on the one hand, yeah, these things have given us more movies, more goods, made it easier to move stuff from place to place, made products cheaper, and made the average person at home wealthier. I've got tons of movies, and I can afford to buy tons of books, presumably because they're all relatively cheap and inflation hasn't been totally out of control, some of which is almost certainly Reagan's doing. But on the other hand, I should emphasize that while many supporters of Reaganomics paint the world in this particular light, many opponents argue that really Reagan's policies only serve to enrich rich people, people who are already at the top of the pyramid. One of the other statistics that is often bandied about when talking about trickle-down economics and the legacy of Ronald Reagan's deregulation is the fact that in the 1970s and 80s, the rich and the poor were actually way closer than they are today. That the gap between the amount of money made by an executive at Amazon and the amount of money made by a minimum wage worker at an Amazon warehouse is truly staggering and even embarrassing. The wage gap is greater than it has ever been, according to these critics of this kind of economics. On some level, that too is pretty obvious. The difference between a millionaire like Donald Trump in the 1980s and his lowest paid worker was probably a lot closer than, you know, multi-billionaire Elon Musk or Jeff Bezos today and the average person who is, you know, shopping at Amazon or going on Facebook or buying, you know, any of the things from Amazon.com. It's messy. It's tricky. But what I want to stress is whether or not we agree with Reagan, whether or not we think he was awful, and for certain groups, especially for, like, gay people in the 1980s suffering from AIDS without any help from Reagan's government and even sort of being lambasted by Reagan's government, we should stress he is a decisive figure, but he very much made the world what it is today in many ways. On the art level, I should definitely stress that along with Reaganomics and the deregulation of all of these corporations comes a new kind of world of corporate art, which I say carefully because that has its own sort of specific meaning. But I should stress that, like, once upon a time, you know, there were some pretty strict codes in place to prevent Hollywood from being excessively political, either conservative or progressive. A set of codes that prevented Hollywood from using too terribly explicit material in their movies. Many of these codes and policies changed in Reagan's day. And one of the most notable ones was that there were some pretty strict restrictions on whether or not, like, how Hollywood made material for children. Like, you could not make a television show that was specifically promoted to, like, sell stuff to kids. Reagan got rid of those rules, and as a consequence, in the 1980s, we get a whole bunch of television that is basically just, like, commercials, but also a 20-minute animated show to show to kids. Transformers is kind of the obvious example. Like, here is this toy that you know, this one toy company in America has imported from Japan, and they're trying to sell it to Americans, and consequently they come up with this, like, really cheaply made, really kind of poor quality, like, animated kid show to air on the wave so people will go out and buy their toys. This extends also to, like, you know, He-Man and the Masters of the Universe, or, like, the Ghostbusters TV show, or, you know, there were just a ton of these things in the 1980s, many of which are beloved by, like, Gen X faithfuls who grew up with this stuff. Like, I can't admit, I haven't watched many of these, but I can definitely point to my own childhood in the 1990s, growing up on, like, Pokemon and Yu-Gi-Oh! And basically the same effects being there. Like, I would buy Pokemon games and Pokemon cards because I was watching the show, and vice versa. This is dodgy, it is definitely questionable from an ethical standpoint. Like, having now watched, you know, my sister's kids grow up and be sort of indoctrinated by television or YouTube to want to buy stuff, it's weird and it's creepy, and I don't like it. But at the same time, what I want to stress for our purposes is whatever your convictions, whatever your beliefs on this topic, this is what art looks like now. You know, I am recording this lecture in 2024. Literally last summer, a Barbie movie was released, which, you know, on the one hand does function in the same way as a commercial for Barbie, but is also possibly going to be an Oscar nominee and is, you know, considered one of the best movies of last year. It can be both. The relationship between art and commerce, art and, you know, consumerism is complicated. But the other thing that we do need to sort of talk about when we talk about Reagan's legacy is the Cold War kind of ended on his watch. Like, not on his watch. It was 1991 before, you know, the Soviet Union really did break up and the Berlin Wall fell. But it is largely due to Reagan-era policies, or at least Reagan-era policies are largely attributed with this. Reagan's policy was, okay, the Russians can't keep up with us, so we're going to outspend them. We're going to make more bombs, and we're going to increase the size of the military. Like, exponentially, we're going to do this. Whether or not this was the direct cause of the breakup, again, this is hotly disputed. This is, again, part of the reason why nobody likes to talk about the Cold War in these broad sort of discussions, because there is a great deal of debate about what exactly caused this to happen. But at any rate, 1991, all that Soviet power sort of evaporated pretty quickly. A whole bunch of nations declared their independence. Berlin was released from Soviet yoke. The Berlin Wall came down, Germany became its own country again. This is kind of it for the Cold War. Like, this thing that had hung over everybody's heads for 30 years and more had very abruptly kind of ended. And again, I'm not going to talk about the causes or the reasons. I just want to sort of address that this is a thing that happened. My expertise is not on the sort of, like, reasons why the Soviets were vulnerable in the 1980s and 1990s, why their power base dried up. Almost certainly it is caused by a lot of the things that we've talked about, the gradual and, like, steady increasing importance of American popular culture. Like, the Hearts and Minds War was hardcore won by Hollywood and the Americans, and not even by, like, the bigwig artists that the CIA was trying to court with, you know, the Iowa Writers' Conference or the Perry Review. Almost certainly it has to do with lack of spending. Like, again, Russian wealth had kind of dried up for, you know, being used as much as it was, and a couple of PR disasters like Chernobyl were enough to really stop up the Russian military and nuclear program. And some of it maybe was things like Reagan's spending projects or, you know, Reagan's fairly antagonistic view towards the Soviets. It's complicated. It's definitely not my wheelhouse. For now, I want to look not so much at why this happened, but what happened as a result. With the end of the divided world, with the end of this sort of Cold War between the Russians on the one hand, the Soviets, and the Americans on the other, we see a new age of globalization. Those same economic interests that Reagan so promoted in the 1980s have, by the 90s, become incredibly powerful. And without, you know, the threat of global communist destruction or nuclear annihilation hanging over on everyone's heads, those companies felt free to expand and conquer the world in a way that neither the, like, U.S. proper nor the Russians could properly do. This became the age of the megacorporation, these global, international corporate interests with bases and projects all over the world. And kind of the biggest symbol of this is the World Trade Center. Constructed in the late 1980s in New York City, this became kind of the center for international, multinational corporations, you know, just down the street from the New York Stock Exchange, now the most powerful, like, stock exchange in the world. This was the center of the global economy in a very real sense. But the other image I'm including here is literally a sort of chart, a map of McDonald's expansion. And if you just give it a cursory look, you'll notice most of the expansion is happening during the 1990s. Like, yeah, there are a handful of countries that have either adopted McDonald's in the 1970s, usually European or in Australia, or in the 80s, like some of the South American countries. But again, you look at most of these, and it's almost like it's got to be almost half of them are in the 1990s. Uruguay in 91, Chile in 1990, Peru in 96, Ecuador in 97, South Africa in 95, Egypt in 94, Morocco in 92, Portugal in 91, Russia, of course, in 1990 as the Cold War is kind of breaking up, and China to boot. Like, even India in 96, despite the fact that McDonald's' primary sort of, like, famous product is hamburgers made out of cow, which India doesn't eat, or at least that's another complicated conversation, but nonetheless, even in India and Sri Lanka in the 1990s, like, it's wild how big these corporations become, how the world becomes increasingly small, and the same kind of industries, the same kind of businesses can be found everywhere. But globalization comes with a dark side as well. As much as this is probably the most boring chart on this PowerPoint presentation, this is the most exciting version and the most complete version I could find of basically the supply chain involved in something like making Nike shoes or, you know, Gap clothes or something. And what I want to stress is this globalization comes with complexity and dependency as much as it is also a sort of statement of wealth and expansion. Increasingly, we are seeing the supply chains look like, hey, we're going to get our raw materials from Africa or from, you know, poorer countries in Southeast Asia or South America, and we're going to ship these natural materials over to factories, which are employing minimum wage workers and, again, fairly low-paying company or countries, places without OSHA or, you know, restrictions on how little a person can be paid, where they will take this these materials and turn them into secondary materials. We take cotton and turn it into yarn. We take oil and turn it into plastic. And then we're going to take these raw materials and we're going to ship them again to either Asian corporations or North American corporations, again, often hiring people at the lowest possible wages to assemble them into whatever product that we are going to be making, at which point we ship those products over to major corporations who will then ship them to stores and suppliers and all sorts of retail outlets. And again, like, the same chunk of plastic or the same, you know, drop of oil or, like, bit of cocoa or whatever product we're talking about is going to go around the world three times before it actually ends up in the stores where you buy it and bring it home and use it. But I also want to stress that as much as this chart is dry and doesn't include any countries, like, I was really hoping to get an actual map that shows, like, movement from place to place on this one. What I should stress is that it's called globalization because everybody's involved, but this is more of a pipeline. It is going through different countries to land in North America, in Western Europe, in rich nations. Like, once upon a time, we used to call this the difference between the first world and the third world. Now, my understanding is that the term is we prefer the developing nations versus the developed nations. Both of these are incredibly condescending. What I want to stress, though, is that the rich are getting richer and the poor are getting poorer. Just as we talked about with, like, rich people getting richer under Reagan's deregulation, we should stress that on a global scale, this is also the case. What we are seeing here is the natural wealth and resources of countries that are not as well off flowing into countries where they are very well off. This is basically just colonialism or imperialism with a couple of extra steps. And I realize this is me just putting on my political hat on this one. Yes, again, I am not a politician. I am not an economist. This is not my area of expertise. Nonetheless, you can't look at this information for very long without getting this sense. If, in fact, trickle-down economics is supposed to be working, presumably these poorer nations should be getting wealthier. But it's not that simple. It is much more complicated than that. And when you think about the fact that these same countries that are providing these natural resources are also the ones that are suffering the most under climate change, while these countries over here that are the beneficiaries of all these resources are also the ones primarily responsible for climate change, it gets super ugly super fast. This, to some degree, is my area of expertise. ask me in an ethics class sometime what I think about the world of the global economy. To some degree, there are advantages which I haven't talked about here. Again, that communication back and forth means that we are also exporting knowledge and exporting art and entertainment and literature and culture to places that arguably are struggling to develop their own. Maybe that's a good thing, maybe that's not a good thing. Again, it's hopelessly complicated. What I'm looking at here, though, is really the effects. And the effects from the art perspective is, hey, art is also becoming global. As much as Hollywood is, in fact, based in these states and producing material mostly for American audiences, increasingly markets overseas are becoming bigger and more powerful, and they are either developing industries of art and literature and culture like Bollywood in India, or Tollywood for that matter, or, you know, major film companies in Russia or China or Japan. As much as these are developing alongside Hollywood's interests, it's also significant to note that Hollywood is increasingly attentive to the desires of international audiences, for both good and bad. Like, again, we kind of stress here in the 21st century the negative sides of this, how Hollywood is, you know, politically going to appease China rather than, you know, putting, say, pro-Taiwan independence material into their films. But at the same time, Hollywood is increasingly attentive to the art styles, the literary styles, the perspectives of other nations as well. The two movies that I picked here, this is a Russian movie poster for Independence Day, a big hit in the 1990s. I picked this one largely because, as much as it is very much pro-American nonsense and a very silly movie, even though I do deeply love it, it is, at the end of the day, a movie about international cooperation, a movie about international culture, a movie that celebrates the different perspectives and people working together, even from different cultures and attitudes, against a common enemy. This was kind of quietly revolutionary in its way in the 1990s, and it was kind of a really interesting gambit insofar as it is this movie that is going to be marketed overseas to Russia, China, Japan, etc., and does want them over on our side by talking about how much we have in common, emphasizing how much the global community is and should be our priority. Likewise, here I have, I believe it's a Japanese poster for Star Wars Episode I, The Phantom Menace. IPs and popular culture artifacts like Superman or Bugs Bunny extend to these works of art like Star Wars or Lord of the Rings or James Bond or whatever. What I want to stress is Hollywood is increasingly finding markets for things that are not specifically set in America, not American-centric. Star Wars, in being a space fantasy story with no connection to our world or its particular cultural assumptions, leaves it open to consumption by everyone, everywhere. It is friendly to other perspectives and other cultures in a way that frequently American-made material isn't, which kind of extends to even more weird and paradoxical examples. Like, for some reason, Captain America is really popular in China and Japan. Not because he represents American interests. In fact, Marvel has gone well out of their way to emphasize that Captain America is kind of frequently questioning American policy and politics. But that still represents the sort of reach and power that these intellectual properties, these works of art as works of corporate gain and works of, you know, commercial interest tend to operate. This is kind of what I want to get at. This is the world that I want to sort of leave you with as we come to the end of the 1990s. A world that is optimistically looking forward to cooperation, to artistic, you know, sort of like cultural and artistic unification and explosion. You know, there are dangers to having a monoculture for sure, but it does mean that we are looking at a world that promises utopian aspirations once again, rather than the negativity and threat of nuclear annihilation. Now, if we continue with this story beyond the 90s, it gets fairly dark fairly quickly. And there's probably no symbol, no, you know, invention, no creation of the 1990s that more obviously exemplifies this move towards global cooperation, this move towards a sort of cultural unification as the internet. Like, in the late 90s, the internet stopped being this sort of, you know, thing that was the playground of intellectuals and academics and, you know, specialists. And instead became something readily available, something that everybody had in their own home. Like, admittedly, it was dial-up. It was very slow and cumbersome and not nearly the kind of internet that you're talking about today. I mean, just look at half of these images. But nonetheless, this was a tool that unified people in a way that was never even thinkable before. Like, when we talked about the printing press, we emphasized that, you know, you went from being able to make a book in, like, 2 to 3 weeks, if not months, to making thousands of books in a single week. The internet is exponentially more powerful than that. We can spread ideas and share thoughts and, you know, put art or literature in places in an instant. All the way across the world, people can do the same thing that I'm doing, play the same video game I'm playing, or watch the same movie I'm watching, or, you know, this shared culture, this shared perspective means a new way of interacting with each other, a new way of getting along with each other, talking to each other, sharing each other's ideas and perspectives, something that, again, could never have been done before. The internet is a radical, giant, incredible shift towards this potential era of cooperation and, you know, unification. It is a great tool for these things. Now, I imagine that most of you are sort of snickering because you are well aware of the fact that the internet has many other abilities and all of the shared information can lead to as much conflict as it does to cooperation and all these nice things that I'm talking about. But again, this is not abnormal. Like, remember, the printing press caused conflicts as well. The Protestant Reformation and the 30 Years' War are as much a product of the printing press as any of that scientific or artistic cooperation. And we should stress that with the advent of the internet, with these, you know, new cultural artifacts and the dominance of American culture in this new global community coming to the fore, there are going to be people who don't like this, who argue against this, who are sick and tired of seeing the West being the dominant force in, you know, the world culture and commerce today. But that's not part of our story, and I don't want to dwell on it. If we are going to do a lecture after the World War II and talk about the Cold War in the late 1990s, that's fine. But if you ask me to do one about the new millennium, I'm not going to do that. In part because I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about 9/11, but also just in part because as much as I've lived through it, I don't know how to parse it yet. I can tell the story of the Cold War because it is, you know, something that has been told to me in some respect. I've read enough about it, studied it enough academics have talked about it that I can kind of piece it together into a pretty coherent narrative. One that does, in fact, end with incredible economic power on the part of the Americans while also doing so at the cost of cultural diversity on the one hand and by sort of causing lots and lots of people to work for very little pay on the other. Things that should definitely promise the difficulties and troubles to come, but I don't want to sort of dive into those just yet. That's well beyond my ability to understand or process or appreciate as much as I'd like to. I still couldn't give you a thesis on what the new millennium looks like. Even if you were to say, what were the 2000s like, or what were the 2010s like, I'd probably just kinda not have much. But even if we stop with the 1990s, you'd probably be pretty decently justified in asking one particular question. So, what about all those art movements? Like, we've talked about Romanticism and Renaissance art and Neoclassicism and Rococo, and, you know, we talked about 20th century art movements like Cubism and Dada and Surrealism. So what about, like, the late 20th century? What major art movements were going on? What major literary movements were going on? Who were the really important philosophers? And, you know, what books should I be reading if, in fact, I want to do more research? Well, I don't know. I mean, I've read a lot of good books from the 1960s and beyond and seen some pretty impressive art that's, you know, been meaningful or powerful for one reason or another, but I couldn't tell you what's most important. Like, that's one of the weird things about talking about a past that is as recent as the Cold War. Like, at most, we're talking about, like, books and movies and art that's 70 years old at best. And academia usually takes longer than that to figure out, hey, this is a real, live, legitimate classic. Like, I can point to some, sure, but my list is going to be way different from a whole bunch of other people's lists. And what's more, because since the 1960s, we've got all that mass media going around, that means we've got more to parse than ever before. Like, there are television channels that have been running roughly 24 hours a day since 1960. You're telling me that I gotta watch all of that stuff in order to know what all is out there? That's not possible. That's not even remotely possible. That's not even considering the internet since the 1980s. Like, good God, what do you want me to do here? But let's talk about a couple of things, at least. Like, I could talk about postmodernism. Postmodernism is kind of like a big blanket description. We've talked about it in the class before, in all likelihood, but here I am using it more specifically to talk about, like, art that is specifically self-conscious or that questions or interacts with the user in some way. Art that, you know, frequently doesn't look like art in the same way that, like, Marcel Duchamp's fountain doesn't look like art. Like, I definitely remember walking around the Metropolitan Museum of Art and the Modern Art Wing, and one of my, like, friends when I was a little kid saying, I could have done that, and I was like, yeah, I could have too. Like, works of art that are just like a line on a canvas or just a giant block of steel standing upright. Some of this stuff is pretty interesting. Like, you know, up here at the top left, we have Cloud Gate by Anish Kapoor, what is more frequently called The Bean by denizens of Chicago, where it is located. Like, it's interesting, I think, and artistically compelling. It's both, you know, because of its mirrored surface, it kind of shows us the entire city, but you can also, like, look at yourself and see how you're a part of it, but it, like, expands to include the sky, the whole thing is round, so it includes the earth as well. Like, it sort of emphasizes the unity of people and place and all these things. That's kind of neat, though all of that is just personal interpretation, not actually anything that Anish Kapoor has to say about it. But the other art that's kind of really important or really popular or discussed or, you know, debated at this point tends to be debated for weird reasons, reasons kind of unrelated to the content of the art. Like, at the bottom left, there is this artistic installment called Where Shall We Go Dancing Tonight? By Sarah Goldschmied and Eleonora Chiari, which I'm probably horribly mispronouncing. This work is not especially famous, but it is one of many works that in recent years has been mistaken for trash and accidentally cleaned up by someone working at the museum. Like, this was literally all bagged and tagged and getting ready to get thrown out at one point before somebody realized that, oh, this was actually an artistic installment and a horrible mistake has been made. This, I suspect, is kind of deliberate. A lot of postmodern art deliberately questions the nature of what we value, and there is a great deal of trash art or art incorporating trash that is out there sort of held as high art and frequently sort of asks and inspires questions about, like, what is art and what do we value and why do we call this art? But at the same time, like, I couldn't necessarily say that this was an especially famous or important work, just that it's kind of one of several that, weirdly enough, enter the popular consciousness because somebody did something dumb and mistook it for not being art, I guess. Likewise, here at the bottom right is Love is in the Bin, one of Banksy's works, which Banksy has got to be one of the few living artists today that, like, my average student actually knows who they are, so to speak. But this particular painting made quite a stir because apparently it was getting ready to be auctioned off, and mid-auction it started shredding itself. Which, again, asks us some pretty interesting questions about what is art and what is the commercial side of art and should we really be selling paintings for large amounts of money and what is the worth of such a painting and is it in fact valuable only until it is bought and sold? I don't know. Like, as much as this is, you know, something that makes newspapers and does in fact get a bit of a conversation going, this is not necessarily what these artists had in mind or did only sort of tangentially or superficially. We're not talking about these works the same way as we talked about Goethe's Faust, or the way that we talked about, like, you know, the melting clocks of Dali. We aren't talking about what the art is or depicts or portrays. We're talking about the art as a work, question mark? And even then, none of these necessarily are terribly old. They're only instances that I brought up because they are newsworthy in some respect. They are famous enough to penetrate the popular consciousness. If there are other major avant-garde artists working, they are affecting artists. They are changing the conversation in some respect, but much of it we're not privy to. Likewise, if you ask me, okay, so what about literature? Like, all right, professor, I get that you don't spend a whole lot of time in art museums, like you don't live in a major city and, you know, you're doing your best and this, but this really isn't your wheelhouse. What about books? Like, you've read tons of books from the 1960s and beyond, right? And I'd be like, yes, but I couldn't tell you which ones are important. Like, lots of people tell me that Philip Roth is a hugely important artist. I've never read any of his novels. He is, and I don't really meet all that many people who have, like, art critics and literary critics frequently talk about how significant he is, but is he really? Was he just a sort of feature of the 70s? Was he, as David Foster Wallace calls him, just one of the great male narcissists, and in that case, can I successfully ignore him? Lolita, I've read. Lolita's a big deal, was a big deal at one point in time, but largely because it was so inflammatory. It's about this guy who has the hots for a, like, 13-year-old girl, but she kind of seduces him, and the whole novel is kind of, like, asking you how comfortable you are with how weird this situation is. Like, I'm not a huge fan of Nabokov. His later work I really can't stand, but Lolita I find compelling, at least, and apparently, like, lots of people agree with me. Stanley Kubrick made a movie out of it. It's another important movie, like Clockwork Orange. Like, obviously this book is kind of a big deal, but, you know, how big a deal is it? The average person I know hasn't read it, and the people who have read it kind of do so questioningly. Like, was this really a good idea? Is this really art? Is this pornography? Like, what do we even do with this? Or take The Lord of the Rings. Like, I love The Lord of the Rings. If you've listened to my podcast beyond the lectures that I present for this class, then you've probably heard me talk about Tolkien at some point. He's great. I consider this one of the greatest books of the, you know, latter half of the 20th century. It's also fantasy, which means that most English classrooms aren't even going to give him the time of day, aren't even going to consider incorporating him into the literary canon. There's quite the move to push back against this. Like, I know plenty of Tolkien fans who are absolutely livid that this is the case, who are absolutely arguing that these should be considered with any other great work written in the 20th century, that Tolkien, you know, was passed over for the Nobel Prize, and, you know, unjustly. But I'm just reporting it to you. Like, yeah, I like the books. Are they important? Are they literary? Are they one of the great works of the 20th century? That's not necessarily something I can tell you. Toni Morrison, I feel pretty comfortable about. I think she's one of the few writers that I can say is a really important writer of the 20th century and the late 20th century at that. She's won a Nobel Prize, which is already a good start. Her works are, in fact, very literary, dealing with important themes and topics, especially racism. Toni Morrison is herself an African-American woman. But also that they are just well-written. They're entertaining. Like, there are a lot of books like Philip Roth's Great American Novel that kind of seem terrible when you're reading them. Which is not to say that Roth himself does. I'm sure Roth is fine, but kind of not my thing. I have read my fair share of this book is important and you should read it and couldn't get through it, like I did with Gravity's Rainbow. We'll talk about that in a moment. Toni Morrison, I can totally get through. I've read Beloved. I enjoyed Beloved. It was tough to read because it's so emotional, but otherwise it's great. I probably think The Song of Solomon or Paradise is even better. Toni Morrison absolutely deserves her accolades. But, and this is kind of the trick here, as much as she is a really big deal, important from the artistic perspective and, you know, Nobel Prize winner and all these things, I'm not sure she's someone that most people have read outside of, like, a college classroom or something. Like, this is a book that you might encounter during, you know, your high school English curriculum, but it's probably not one you're going to necessarily pick up to read for fun. Increasingly, the idea of a book being literary is actually kind of a demerit. It means that it's going to sell fewer copies. It's going to mean that people care about it less. Like, more people have read James Patterson or, you know, The Da Vinci Code than have read Beloved, even though Beloved is probably the far superior work, assuming that I'm the one to judge, which we shouldn't. Likewise, over here I've got Angels in America. It was a two-part play written by Tony Kushner, hugely groundbreaking in its time. This, you know, this whole play from a gay perspective, looking at the 1980s in America, and it's just fascinating, and the dialogue is crackling, and Tony Kushner has got to be one of the best writers we've got. And once again, I'm not sure how many people have ever read this. Like, I read it in college because it was kind of a big deal that my college was one of the first to perform Angels in America on the Eastern Seaboard. They were very proud of themselves for that, and they included it in the curriculum as a consequence. And I'm kind of proud of them, too. It's a great play. Like, I've really fallen in love with it in recent memory, even though initially I was kind of hesitant and grossed out by it. But at the same time, like, Kushner's kind of a big deal in play and theater circles and Broadway circles, but the average person may not have read these. Like, of all the books that we've just talked about, only Tolkien, well, I think honestly most of them have in fact a movie adaptation. Kubrick made the adaptation of Lolita. Peter Jackson, not Percy Jackson, that's a different person, or different non-person. Peter Jackson made his epic trilogy of The Lord of the Rings, as well as another one on The Hobbit, which was not nearly as good. Most people are familiar with The Lord of the Rings, though they are not familiar with Lolita necessarily. Beloved did have a movie adaptation, though my understanding is it won a couple Oscars and no one has ever talked about it since. Angels in America got like a HBO like miniseries, which was kind of a big deal when I was in college because that was when it was coming out, but I don't know exactly how well anyone cares about it now. Which is why I also include Stephen King's The Shining. Because this is a book that I honestly didn't care for all that much. Also a book that got adapted into a movie by Stanley Kubrick, weirdly enough. But it is also popular. Like, I know lots of people who have read The Shining or who have watched the movie or who know what its deal is, even if it isn't literary. So, if we've been talking in this class about what works of art, what art movements really affect the popular culture, which change cultural consciousness, I really wouldn't know which ones to point you towards on this list. Tolkien is more influential, but maybe less literary because of his genre selections. King has a huge sort of cultural cachet, but back in the 80s, as people die off who, you know, grew up with his work, there's a decent chance that he will be forgotten as well. Morrison is almost certainly important from a literary perspective, but I'm not entirely sure how much she's penetrating the popular consciousness. And as much as Roth was considered a big deal in his day, it's pretty obvious that fewer people consider him important now. So what is literature? I don't know. I don't know which of these books to recommend as being the definitive statement of the 20th century. It's really hard to find any that successfully do the job. Which is why I kind of want us to shift our perspective here. Up until now, I've largely been recommending these works as being emblematic of the time in which they were written. Now, I want to instead of saying this is what that time meant, I want to ask the question, what did this time mean? What makes this era so interesting? And rather than look at specific works, I want to look at kind of those big philosophical questions. What is the relationship between art and popularity? Because again, like in the 18th century and the 19th century, the two were largely the same. A work of art did not get press unless it was popular. And a work that didn't get popular was usually not, you know, widely circulated enough to become art. But nowadays we have a kind of conflict between that. On the one hand, we have incredibly popular landmark movements, which are really important in their moment, but seem to pass shortly afterwards. Like, Elvis was a huge deal in the 1950s and 60s, and he is still considered this landmark artist and is still studied, and people still listen to his work. But I'm not entirely sure how many Spotify lists include Jailhouse Rock next to the likes of Taylor Swift or Rihanna or, you know, Ed Sheeran or any of today's composers. By contrast, here is a shot from Nostalgia by Andrei Tarkovsky, one that actually talks about the fleetingness of time. And it is considered a very important, very, you know, significant, very artistic movie, but I would be willing to bet that none of you watching this have ever seen that movie. I've never seen it. I just know it's important because some people who I know, who I read and care about, say that it is important and I respect their opinions. Is it really that important, though, if it's not making more of an influence on the popular culture? And that's part of the reason why I include Gravity's Rainbow here, partially as a joke. Because literally a couple years ago, we got that movie Knives Out from Rian Johnson, where one of the featured conversations is, you know, he's using an example from Gravity's Rainbow, but when, you know, the main character says, I've never read that book, his response is, nobody ever reads that book. It's important, but nobody cares about it. Can art really do this? Like, I tried to read Gravity's Rainbow. It was tough, and I did not have the patience for it. I do want to take another stab at it, though, because it was more fun to read than a lot of work from that time period. So it is, in fact, on my shelf, waiting for another stab. But I want to ask that question. I don't want this to be like, go read Gravity's Rainbow. It's important. Go watch Nostalgia. It's important. Go listen to Elvis Presley. He's important. No. Some of these will endure. Some of them may not. And that's the way of art. Like, now that we live in the era of mass media, we have just this overwhelming abundance of stuff to listen to or watch or read or, you know, play, as the case may be. Some of that stuff will survive, will, you know, live to be a classic. Much of it won't. And it's kind of hard to say which is which from our particular position, which is why I don't feel comfortable saying which is which, and instead asking that question. But on another level, I want to ask, what is that relationship? If a work becomes so popular, like Elvis, that everybody enjoys it, is it still saying something challenging, something controversial, something that people disagree with? Does a requirement for art include, like, being divisive in some way? Not being just purely popular or enjoyable. But on the other hand, if something is so challenging, so dark or pessimistic, or something so thought-provoking that most people don't appreciate it or enjoy it, can that really be called art? Where are the boundaries here? Likewise, and kind of going along with this, we need to talk about art and commerce. Like, here in art and commerce have always been kind of closely related. Like, even as far back as the Renaissance, and honestly way earlier, we can talk about, like, how the Catholic Church is the one commissioning the creation of the Sistine Chapel ceiling, or many of the works of Michelangelo or the great Renaissance artists, which, again, informs why they are usually composed on Christian themes or about Christian ideas or stories. Now, we have complicated this matter significantly. Like, we've talked about Star Wars before, I think twice now, because A, it's a big deal, and B, it's something that I'm knowledgeable about. Star Wars in its day was incredibly groundbreaking. It was, you know, took Hollywood out of its 70s slump of indie projects that, you know, were very artistic and very sort of, like, slow to get traction, and just jumped Hollywood into the era of the blockbuster, these big movies with huge audiences that were made to popular tastes, usually about genre fiction, like science fiction or fantasy, or, you know, like something like Indiana Jones and his archaeology stories, adventure novel or adventure and action movies and stuff like that. But at the same time, Star Wars also sort of brought into the world the idea of, like, I am going to make this movie, which is a work of art, but then I'm going to finance the crap out of it with other stuff. George Lucas, whether or not you like him as a director or a writer, he was kind of brilliant at marketing. All those toys that he sold, all the action figures, all the spaceships, all the, you know, I still have, like, Micro Machines Star Wars toys littered around my office, and Star Wars Legos, and you name it. Like, he figured out that the money was not in the movie and the box office, it was in all the peripheral stuff. It was in making a franchise that people wanted to be involved in. And this whole art and commerce question gets even more complicated when you think of the fact that Lucas was kind of kicked out of his own project, sold it off to Disney, who now gets to make it without any of his approval. Where, then, is the artistic integrity, I wonder? What, then, is Star Wars in this case? Something that is very hotly debated online, and I don't recommend you look at any of it, because it's all horrible. in most cases, but the question remains relevant and interesting. Likewise, over here on the top right, a less sort of famous but no less interesting example is we have these two works of art, two bronze statues, Charging Bull by Arturo de Modica and Fearless Girl by Kristen Visbal. In the 2017, I want to say, is when Fearless Girl was initially displayed here opposite Charging Bull. It's since been removed at de Modica's request and other reasons that we're about to get into. Fearless Girl was largely understood to be sort of a art depicting especially feminist resistance to specifically patriarchal and corporate interests. The Charging Bull was understood to be represented as this symbol of, like, bull markets and, you know, financial gain, and, you know, both of these statues are literally, like, right next to Wall Street. The trouble is that this was actually not the case so much. Charging Bull was actually a work of guerrilla art. Arturo de Modica just dropped it off there one night in the middle of the night in 1984, shortly after the market problems that had been taking place there. And the city of New York originally removed it, considered it vandalism, but it was returned by popular demand. Fearless Girl, on the other hand, was commissioned by a hedge fund specifically targeting women. And the plaque that she was dropped on that usually said, "She will resist," with "she" in all caps, was actually like "she," S-H-E, the NASDAQ ticker symbol for that hedge fund. Like, Fearless Girl is actually this super cynical, super corporate Wall Street art, you know, like, shenanigan pulled for their own publicity and popularity. It's kind of gross, but people still found themselves inspired by it. The question that I want to ask then is, what is more important? The people who paid for the art or the legacy that it kind of takes on regardless of that? Is Charging Bull actually a work of art for corporate interest and, you know, supporting capitalist ideology, even if that wasn't the way that Modica intended it? Is Fearless Girl a symbol of feminist resistance, even if it was really cynical in its original production? Do any of these questions even matter? Because these questions are going to keep coming up. Who is paying the bills for these works of art? Whether art can and cannot be made with or without these bills, we're going to have questions about movies that don't get made because they aren't going to be profitable, works of art that do not get produced because they do not support corporate interests, and those corporations are the only ones that can finance them. This is really tricky stuff. And these are questions that you should be attentive to as you deal with art in the world beyond both today and in the future. Likewise, we should also talk about the effects of the art on the artist. There are a lot of artists who became celebrities in the 20th century. Mass media enabled not just their work to be widely disseminated, but their lives to be widely disseminated as well. Sometimes with really tragic or really damaging consequences. John Lennon was shot, largely because he resumed his career and, you know, had some pretty controversial political opinions. Michael Jackson was either enabled to do some pretty crazy and horrible stuff and then had his crazy, horrible stuff revealed to the public at large. And many celebrities have fallen in similar ways. We've had lots of destructive stories about celebrities with really bad habits or who fall into drug addiction, who destroy themselves or kill themselves because of their fame, because of their popularity, whose celebrity reveals their misdeeds and their bad choices, and we have to reckon with these things. What do we do with the fact that one of these famous artists whose work we admire and appreciate is in fact a pedophile or is in fact harboring politically dissident convictions? What do we do with that? Does that affect the way that we understand the art that we look at? Does that change our relationship to it? Does that change the art that we can consume or that we can enjoy? Which brings us kind of to the next big question. We frequently talk about art as consumption, as though we are just taking it in, which is itself kind of a 20th century phenomenon, the idea that we are just sitting there gradually receiving art all of the time, rather than going out of our way to have an artistic experience, like going to the museum or going to the opera, or, you know, picking up a book and specifically reading it after going out of our way to acquire it. Now art is all around us. Now we all have televisions and computers and laptops and cell phones. We are bombarded with, you know, advertising and media all of the time. But even this is only partially true. increasingly in the 20th century, we're seeing a sort of more complicated interaction between art and the audience. I put here the first edition of the Advanced Dungeons & Dragons Handbook, a classic of the 70s that would grow to be a wide international phenomenon by our own age. But what I want to stress is that, who is the artist in the case of Dungeons & Dragons? You can point to Gygax and say he is the one who created the rules, he is the greatest of the dungeon masters, but at the end of the day, Dungeons & Dragons is a game played between a dungeon master and the participants, who create their own story using just the slightest amount of guidance on the part of Gygax and his, you know, functionaries going into the future. Role-playing games and video games in general very much blur the line between the artist and the audience. And Dungeons & Dragons is kind of famous for having many, many people working on it over the course of its existence. Some who are paid officially by Wizards of the Coast or whoever owns the license at any given moment. Some who are not, who just upload their information, their ideas, and their settings and stories onto the internet to be enjoyed by anyone. So who then is the artist? Who then is the audience? If you can go home after enjoying a, you know, Dungeons & Dragons session and compose your own campaign, then where are these boundaries drawn? And, importantly, in the Dungeons & Dragons conversation, who gets to make money off of them? Because increasingly, Wizards of the Coast, owner of the license, is resistant to the idea of independent artists creating their own Dungeons & Dragons material with the license, but without paying court to Wizards & Company. Likewise, the audience can affect the outcome of works or change the way a work is perceived. Up at the top right is a rather extreme example. Shortly after Salman Rushdie wrote The Satanic Verses, a novel of, if I'm not mistaken, the 1970s, he was very much excommunicated from the Islamic faith, and there was a violent sort of series of repercussions. The Irony's government basically condemned him outright, and multiple Irony's agencies posted a bounty on his head to anyone who would kill him. Not violent protests, but activists would go into the streets claiming that they would and wanted to kill Salman Rushdie on behalf of the Quran and the Islamic faith. This almost certainly changed what Rushdie was going to do with the rest of his life. And as much as this is an extreme example, we can point to a lot of examples in the 20th century of artists who have had to revise or shift their perspectives, the outcome of their art, because their audience has reacted to it, has changed it in some way. Where once upon a time, the artist would produce a work of art, and then that was it. Like, it was then done. And then people could react to it as they saw fit. Sometimes that would affect the trajectory of the artist's career, sometimes it wouldn't. It wouldn't affect the original artwork itself. In many cases nowadays, that's not true. An artist who is condemned or objected to could very well have their entire career derailed in real time as they are working on the work, as was the case with someone like Boris Pasternak, not being able to publish his work in Soviet Russia and then suddenly having his life endangered when it was published overseas. Salman Rushdie, too, his career is jeopardized. And on a much less level, we can point to things like Hollywood changing the trajectory of movie releases or film releases or, you know, television narratives or book narratives because people figure out plot points or because online communities end up, you know, causing trouble about them. Star Wars might have been a very different animal if there hadn't been vicious protests against, you know, The Last Jedi or any of the new developments in the era of J.J. Abrams and Disney's ownership of the license. These works of art either stopped existing or changed rejection or changed their appearance because of the audience interacting with them. And we should also be attentive to the way that art can affect the audience. On the one hand, by opening this discussion up, we open up a lot of stuff I don't want to talk about. But on the other hand, we should at least mention. In the 1990s, there was a big deal with people being worried about violent video games turning their children violent. Doom was one of the big examples. I showed the two shareware discs from Doom back on the internet page. But one of the games that sort of leaned into this phenomenon was a game called Postal, which was deliberately over-the-top violent. Like, you are literally this person who just, like, gets up one day and then decides to shoot up his entire town. And that's, like, the entire game. Like, you just go and kill people in this little suburban community and, you know, that's all you do. And it was deliberately meant to be controversial. It was deliberately meant to be over the top. And on the one hand, video games very much got ruled as being a work of art and therefore enjoying the same protections as other artworks, but there were multiple politicians in the 90s and early 2000s who very much argued that video games and would cause people to be violent, and therefore they should be either banned or controlled, or violent video games should be censored altogether. That's not necessarily what I am suggesting, but what I am suggesting is that we be conscious about this. In the 1990s, this was a cheap way to score political points. You would get all those pearl-clutching mothers by saying, "Think of the children and what they will do." That was ridiculous. But it seems less ridiculous in the 2010s and 2020s when there are literally people who shoot up schools and temples who write in their manifestos that they used Call of Duty as a training simulator. This is complicated. And we should be attentive to the effects of the art on the audience. We should be aware and wary of consuming art that promotes bad ideas or bad perspectives, whether it's propaganda like we've seen in, you know, the various like posters and stuff that we've talked about in this lecture series, or whether it's something as seemingly benign as, you know, Goethe's The Sufferings of Young Werther causing tons of people to commit suicide, whether directly or indirectly, or whether it is something as potentially pernicious as a work of art that, whether deliberately or, you know, unintentionally, champions a potentially damaging or evil ideology, whether it is propaganda for white supremacy or a politically problematic faction or ideal, whether it causes people to become violent or whether it promotes violence, whether it encourages violence. This should be something on our radar as well. But again, what I want to stress is I don't have answers to these questions. I'm a philosopher. I ask questions. That's my job. What I want you to do is think about those questions, to not take the art of the 20th century or the 21st for that matter for granted. To be aware of the context here. Because the upshot of all of this, like more than any of the you know, like tests or quizzes that I'm assigning in this class, more than any of this, I want to stress that you are a part of this historical process. And the word that I'm using here, historiography, this is usually the word that describes the study of history, in short. And while that sounds like the most dry, boring thing on the planet, what I want to stress is that this is about understanding the story of history and also creating the story of history. One of the reasons why so many people are so resistant to talking about the world since 1950, since World War II, is because to do so, to organize or cherry-pick events or works of art, works of literature, is to essentially present history with a certain logic that it does not have. It is to turn history, just the events that define our lives, into a story. And by turning it into a story, we, whether intentionally or unintentionally, give it meaning. We decide what it means. And in this class, for most of these PowerPoint presentations, I've been doing that without questioning it. And you've been taking it in without questioning it. You assume I am correct when I say that the printing press caused, you know, the Protestant Reformation or the Scientific Revolution. You assume I am correct when I say that there are these two views of European politics in the 18th century, the one embodied by, you know, the revolutions of Civil War era England, and the I am the state absolute monarchy of Louis XIV. You assume that I'm correct when I say that the 70s were pessimistic and that the age of the nuclear arsenal became a grim one hanging over the head of everybody who lived here. You assume all of these things, and yet you probably shouldn't. It's more complicated than anything that I'm making it out to be, and by organizing it in this way, yes, I am giving it meaning. I am making it mean something. And like I said, I am stopping very hard at 1999. I don't want to talk about 9/11. I don't want to talk about the 2000s or 2010s. Because I want you to do that. I am asking questions because it's time for me to quit telling you what to think. That's my job as your teacher. Not to, you know, educate you and give you all the things to memorize, but to prepare you so that now you can do it yourself. Now you can go out and see some work of art or see some headline or see some, you know, big political act or rally and say to yourself, where does this fit into the narrative? What does this mean? why is this happening? And what does it mean for the future? Because at the end of the day, it's for you to decide whether the pessimism of the 1970s in the wake of Watergate brought forth a paranoia that basically brought about the era of conspiracy theories in the 2000s, or whether it gave us the clarity of perspective to resist propaganda and propagandizing into the 21st century. It's up to you to decide whether 9/11 was in fact, you know, this horrible thing that happened to America that America will never let happen again, never forget, we will destroy all the terrorist organizations who threaten us, or whether it is the wake-up call for a global economy that has run out of control and has in fact been making a lot of people's lives miserable. It is up to you to decide whether the consolidation of Hollywood into franchises and under the mantle of Disney's masthead is in fact something that brings on a new era of creativity and diversity, or in fact stifles that. Or, for that matter, you can say to yourself that it is all doomed, that it is all going to end soon, that we are going to see a new era of filmmaking or art or literature or whatever. It is up to you to decide whether the globalization of the 1990s brings in a new era of economic prosperity for the whole world, or whether it is responsible for all the pollution that ends up destroying it. These are questions I can't answer, because we don't know the end of this story. No one ever does. There is no end as far as we're concerned. And if we find it, well, that'll be the least of our problems. It's your job to make sense of this, your job to answer these questions now. I've done all I can. So do not do history passively, because this is on your shoulders now. It's up to you to make meaning, or let somebody else make that meaning for you. Somebody whose agenda might not be as benign as a professor sitting in a college classroom. Somebody who may want you to buy something, or somebody who may want to take that power that you invest them with and use it for potentially troubling or problematic ends. You're in charge now. You are the future, they say, and it is trite and it is cliche and it is also very, very true. You not only are the future, you decide what the future is. You get to tell us what the future means. You get to take everything that I've told you and either spin it into a new story or make some new story out of it. Go for it. That's what you're here for. It's an enormous responsibility. It's part of why I don't like talking about history this close to the present. But it is something we and I have to do. And it is now going to be yours more than it is mine. I am already aging out of this role. I've only got so many years left. You, on the other hand, if you are a young person starting off your career, this is all potential. This is yours, your story to tell. So, go tell it. This is where my role ends, and this is where yours begins.